Well, we'll give it the best crack we can. I spent a number of years, just about 15 years, as the security manager and also first responder for Cambridge Regional College. Spent a lot of time there, spent a lot of time with young people, and encountered a lot of different issues. As you know, I've come to a conclusion that I've also been an emergency first responder for the ambulance service for about 20 years. And of course, we're talking about physical health, aren't we? Somebody breaks their leg or something happens to them, or they've been in an accident. And so we turn up and we do the best we can for them in a physical way. Well, we have a strict code of practice for that. We have a line of defence, because if you think about it, when you turn up to something, you think, what do I do? If you've ever stopped at an RTC, road traffic collision, or someone's fallen over in the road or anything, the first thing you think, first, most people think, oh, should I do anything? Yes, I should do something, but what is it? So I always teach a particular method of approaching these issues. But I've also found with dealing with mental health issues, which I have done, you probably guessed, we also need a strategy, don't we? You can't see that broken leg, you can't see the broken arm, you can't see the injuries. But you know, some of the protocol that we use is really useful. I don't know if anybody's heard of the chain of survival. Have you heard of that? Chain of survival. If you go on Google, you will see chain of survival. Every paramedic knows it. Hospitals know it. It's very well known. I teach it at my first aid courses. And you know what? It works very well, slightly amended, for mental health issues. Now the first thing, it's four rings. They intertwine together, they look a little bit like the Olympic rings, they look like. And inside them, there are leads for responders like myself, for other people. If you think, what do I do? You've got to start somewhere. Start with the chain of survival. And I've got loads of stuff here. I could stand here for the rest of the day and go through things. But I thought, for you guys, if I bring the chain of survival into your mind, that might help you know where to start. Now the first ring, early recognition. Now if somebody's sick or something happens to them physically, it's early recognition. If you don't recognise it, you're not going to do anything about it, are you? No one's, if you don't know what's wrong, if you think nothing's wrong with them, you're not going to do anything about it. So it's about early recognition. We'll talk about how we do that in a moment. But just the chain of survival is enough for you at the moment. But we'll pop back to these rings. So early recognition is really important. How do we recognise that that person may be either in or heading for a mental crisis? How do we do that? We'll come back to that. But early recognition, however it's done, is really important. Early intervention. No point in recognising. I call it the red light syndrome. You know, not a lot of point in driving on the road seeing the red light and everyone bother stopping at it. So you've recognised, there it is, early recognition. Ping, there it goes, red light. Well, that's grand then, but we've got to do something about it. The intervention on the road is, do you know what? That is, unless you're a Cambridge cyclist, we're going to stop. That's the action we're going to take. It's red, we're going to do something. No point in seeing it if you're not going to do anything about it. So the early recognition is absolutely cracking. Well done. But if you don't do anything about it, it was sort of pointless.
Ways to cope with stigma. No individual should have to tolerate others treating them differently because of a mental health condition. That is what we were saying.
Yeah.
People should not be afraid. You should not be afraid to approach your friends and ask them, are you okay? And really ask them and look at them. And I don't mean cross-question them. Feel if they're okay. Just open your mind and your heart and feel, whatever they say, are they okay? Because there should be no stigmatisation to mental health issues. And we are going a long way down the road for that not to happen. Things are getting better and hopefully they will get even better. But you can help combat stigma, seeking professional help. which is what we said. Seeking diagnosis, seeking early intervention, get them to seek professional help. Sometimes you might need to help them do that. Because people in a mental health crisis are not always in a place to seek help, are they? You know, they're just going to go, I'm not going to do that. It's all very well saying, let's phone Mind, let's phone Samaritans. Well, yes, they are there, but maybe they can't do that. But maybe they need perhaps somebody else to help them do that, to the support to do that. If the crisis is deepening, that's quite a lot to get your phone out, isn't it? And just have a look and say, you know, well, what is this number of Samaritans? What is the number? You can get a little card called care cards, and they've got those numbers on them. And they're quite handy, just little cards, they're quite handy to keep in the phone, the cover of your phone, if you're old fashioned like me and actually like to have a little cover, if you're not doing it. So I tend to keep stuff like that in the phone because I might need it, and maybe you won't, but those little care cards are really worth having rather than have to look for those numbers. But somebody in that situation just may not be able to look for you, help them. But you have to do it also with their consent. That might take a little time. You know, it's taken a long, 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 long time with some people. It's taken us just a long time to actually get their consent to dial a help number. Because if you haven't got their consent and you do it anyway, how effective is it going to be? So we need to try and get, if you can, if they're friends, that's where your friend circle comes in, to get their consent. It's really important because to retain their dignity. Simply because they're having a crisis doesn't mean that their dignity needs to be removed. We need to help them with that dignity, and we need to move forward with them caringly, with dignity, and as professionally as we can to seek the assistance that they need at their request. We can't make people do anything when on the police. We can't do that. Showing family and friends reliable information to improve their understanding, that's what we're trying to do here.
Yeah.
Not equating themselves with their condition. It's just part of what they are for that moment. Joining support groups to talk about stigma and relate to others. It's here, but joining a support group, it depends on the sort of person you are. But for me, I would find that quite difficult. You might find that difficult to understand. We stand here, but you might be surprised. It's not for everybody, so that's got to be right for them. They may be better one to one, you may be better one to one, but whichever is the best for you, getting someone to support, or maybe going along with them to support them. Organising local campaigns or getting involved with national campaigns about mental health. That is what you've done today.
Yeah.
You've put something together that is really important. It just so happens that the situation we found ourselves in this week with the escalating crisis has put a lot of people off.
Mm-hmm.
But you have still done a really good thing. We're all here talking about it, aren't we?
Yeah. Thank you.
But you've done a great thing.
Thank you so much.
Do it again.
Thank you.
Really. When things pick up, do it again. I probably won't be the name there, but.
I hope you are.
I can still come back if you want to. But,
sure.
Just a couple of statistics and then I'm going to shut up because as you can see I've been a long time with my. So, just a couple of statistics for you. This might surprise you, and I checked it out today, but 1 in 4 adults experience at least one diagnosable mental health problem in any given year. That's quite something, isn't it? Half of all mental health problems are established or thought to be established by the age of 14. Poor mental health carries an economic and social cost of £105 billion a year in England and £10.8 billion a year in Scotland. In 2018 in Great Britain, there were 595,000 cases of work-related stress, depression or anxiety, leading to 15.4 million working days lost. So, for the country, for the economy itself,
yeah.
You know, the country would want these things not to happen, just for economic reasons.
Yeah.
But we don't want them to happen because we're not bothered about that at the moment, are we? We're bothered about the person sitting here or here or here or here or here. That's what we're bothered about. That's what we care about. So guys, I'm going to shut up now. I mean, I just think I'm going to put 2 pages of notes. Good job, I didn't bring the whole book, didn't I? If you leave here today, just thinking about the chain of survival, remember the back to the chain of survival, early recognition, early intervention, early diagnosis, and that means just not clinical diagnosis, but you just recognising something is wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And early advanced care, meaning early professional intervention, if that person will allow you to do it. And if they won't, if it's for their own good, you need to go and seek extra help yourself. And this is the final point I'm going to make. I have a big danger card, especially when I teach first aid. I guess those of you who have been on first aid courses, what they said, first thing I always say, danger, isn't it? You know, look after your own danger and all that. But what they do is they tend to skip by it. But danger, personal danger is a really big thing for rescuers. Because there's no point in me, if you want my help, there's no point in me flying up the stairs at 1,000 miles an hour, tripping on the fourth step and breaking my arm, is there? I'm not going to be able to help you. So I have to go out there at the rate, and see the kit we have to carry, that where you get there, and you're going to be in some fit state to help that person. This is the same. You need to maintain your own mental well-being if you are trying to help or assist a friend or colleague, or even a staff member. It doesn't matter who it is. We're all just folks. It's all we are. It doesn't matter whether we're 6, 16, 60. It doesn't matter. We're just folks trying to get along. It doesn't matter who it is. But look after yourselves. Look after your own mental. It can take quite a toll if you've had to mentor someone or persuade them to get the intervention they need. If you feel really tired at the end of a couple of hour session, you've done a really good job. That's because you've actually achieved it.
Mm-hmm.
But then you need to look after your own mental health. Go and talk to somebody. Go and talk to your own friends. But look after yourselves, people. So I'll leave you with 2 thoughts. The chain of survival, please look it up. I know it's a medical one, but that will mind you.
Mm-hmm.
And look after your own mental health, your own well-being, mm-hmm. in your efforts to sustain others. I think that will do you.
Wow. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Rhythm sick.
YG.
I see you, Stella.
It's my class, my class.
I've been through ups and downs. I've been through pain and tears. Then I heard the voice of God. He has shown me the way, I'm never turning back. I don't be a promise, so I'm a enema demon. Menene na mami suro, frese nyami woka mi home. Adumbi ya tome so, ama ene majimi mu. Menene na mami suro, frese nyami woka mi home. Onu ni mekani ya, the Lord is my light, yeah. Onu ni mekani ya, the Lord is my light, yeah. Enti mini, famu tune so. He has never failed me, he will never fail me. I couldn't imagine, he is always there for me. He has never failed me, he will never fail me. Siti tinya minke bono, bono eh. Makume mwini nanke bono, bono eh. Afano mega nke bono, bono eh. Injenti mife nke bono, bono eh. You died on the cross for me, you shed your blood. I'm standing tall. You died on the cross for me. You shed your blood for me. Your love is pure. With you, I'm standing tall. I don't be a promise. I'm a enema demon. Then I'm a miserable. First thing I'm a coming home. I don't be a promise. I'm a enema demon. Then I'm a miserable. First thing I'm a coming home. Oh, no, name a cania. The Lord is my light, yeah.
a small boat on the ocean, sending big waves into motion, like how a single word can make a heart open. I might only have one match, but I can make an explosion. And all those things I didn't say were wrecking balls inside my brain. I will scream loud tonight. Can you hear my voice this time? This is my fight song. Take back my life song. Prove them all right song. My power is turned on. Stop me right now. I'll be strong. I'll play my fight song. And I don't really care if nobody else believes, 'cause I've still got a lot of fight left in me. Losing friends and I'm chasing sleep. Everybody's worried about me. In too deep. Say I'm in too deep.
Anything that they take that focus away is normally, you know, what we see in movies, what we see on the media. So you always normally, however you watch movies, that whenever the guy is probably recruiting to a depression cycle, the first thing is always alcohol. You always have the bottle and he's always, you know, bumping down bottle after bottle. To have that feeling of escape from what that enormous pressure, the pressure of daily life is. So I feel like there's greater meaning and greater channels to expose and to release all of that stress, and you know, we need to find better ways. One thing personally that helped me, if my personal faith had the good support system I have, because I could easily been like that, or you know, have gone to a dangerous cycle like that. But I've had a wonderful family and wonderful family and friends who always supported me and always give me healthy channels to release all of that. So you know, but for anyone that wants to go, it's Adam. So
that's fine.
So yes, I hope you know that kind of insight for me also this year. You know, there's always other channels and there are more than one ways to get rid of.
Someone have a question? No. Okay.
Alright. So yes, so yeah, that's my insight on that kind of topic. So I'm gonna ask what we have in general. What extent does childhood trauma and other traumas impact on mental health in general?
So I would say the effects of childhood trauma on other people, it depends on the child. So for example, so childhood is a time of security, it's a time where like you are at that time of you should feel protected and loved. But for example, if a child comes from overflow abuse, rigid, in fact it can get a foundation to add to it and it can affect how they view the relationship later in life. So I think it can affect you in a way that you start having self-guilt, blaming yourself for people's mood or people's emotion, suicidal thoughts, depression, or getting defensive, being aggressive. I've had my own share of childhood trauma, and yeah. I realized that slight things I get really angry because people don't understand me, and the way I cope is anger or being aggressive, whether it's aggressive or not. I just really get angry, and I realized that I really affected my self-esteem while growing up, and I wanted to see validation from people. So, what I didn't get from people around me that I trusted, like neighbors or friends, I would say that was no verbal abuse and stuff like that. That really, I realized when I was younger, I didn't see the impact because my coping mechanism was just hiding it away, like just saying, oh, it happened. But as I grew and started forming a relationship, I realized that this things really built me up and they affected me. But I realized that societal thoughts, any slight thing that I can start, societal thoughts are blaming myself for people, switching emotion, and of course, you become really sensitive to lead you to things that most people don't be sensitive to, and your way of reacting to that is anger or being isolating yourself. So I think childhood trauma lay a foundation for the development. So I was asking you. So now we're speaking of young adults. How do you think students should handle depression, transition into adulthood and if moving to university?
I would actually like to follow up that question and bounce it to my friend, Mr. Frankie, because I'm sure he's actually been here for some years. He's now doing his master's degree. So I'm sure you know a lot about student pressure and things like that. You could give us some insights.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much. Yes, you didn't have it. I'm not that old.
Sorry.
Yeah. I've been here 4 years. And yeah, I mean when you're here, with this, especially my own personal experience being here, you see people go through different kinds of emotion, different kinds of situations, trying to cope, you know, some are growing up, you know, some are being far from their family, you know. Yeah. Someone living in different countries, you know, not being far from their family for the very first time. So coping is a bit difficult. They don't know if they have to go to school, they don't know if they want to make friends. So it's really a good question. Now the question says, how should students handle the pressure? There are different ways through which you can handle pressure. and sometimes, and there's not one specific way that applies to everyone. You know, different people have different mechanisms, different ways. Like Kellen Jay said, I've seen people who've been in this country for 4 years, they'll never, after lectures, they just go back to their rooms, animes from morning to night. They don't talk to anyone. It's a mechanism. It's
a
Yeah,
it's anime fans alone.
It's a way. It's a way of helping yourself coping with depression, especially in university. And there are different ways, you know. Again, I think you mentioned quite a few.
Yeah.
Friends, you know, meeting new people, listening, getting to know different people, finding out your perspective, because the likelihood of meeting another person who is also struggling, who is also trying to cope, is really high. So you get to meet different people, you find out, how do you cope with depression? And then through that, through the exchange of ideas, what they do, some people, like, they let me say, some people use pornography, it helps them, some people, music, different things, you see. But as young people, it has to be something that makes you feel happy. You know, any young person wants to feel excited, they want to feel happy. So people look for things that make them feel happy, that make them feel valuable, and they just concentrate. You see, it could be friends, it could be family. Some people just resort back to your family. They can't find any friends on campus, they can't find any friends in university. So they get closer to their family. The family may not be here, but they always be on call. It helps them, you know, with depression. So I don't think there's any specific method of coping with depression.
Just
one. Alright, I'll send a question to Michael.
Yeah.
Right? Okay. So in terms of homelessness, what can make a person withdraw from the responsibility of daily life despite education?
Thank you. That's actually the main question. And like, you know, I was appointed to speak on homelessness here. I don't feel at all an expert on the issue. Thank God I've never been homeless. But I do have been active on homeless due to my lifestyle. I'm a street dancer. Anyway, and I meet a lot. I do encounter a lot of people in my life. Yeah, my heart goes out to everyone who can, you know, who does help homeless people, who does reach out. What can make people withdraw from the responsibilities, I feel like, is not necessarily being homeless, like not having clothes or a roof on their head. It's more being homeless in a way of like not having a home. Not having a, it doesn't have to be a physical home, not having a someone to return to, someone to connect with. And there are people even here in Cambridge who are really intelligent people, who are educated people, who have degrees, but they're still homeless by choice, by circumstances, by different means. Still, I feel like that's what makes people resort to that is feeling alone in the world and feeling like they can't relate to it. Other people are feeling not understood or feeling misunderstood and not knowing how to cope with that and how to, you know, how to relate to other people. Yeah, I feel also just wanted to add that I feel like whenever, you know, homeless or not, whenever you can get someone to smile and find that smile, you know, if you're passing someone who's like, who's just living rough, and if I can get that person, you know, I can just exchange a smile with them in that struggle, you know, I'm going through my own struggle, and if I can get that person to smile, then I can live up that way, you know? I feel like that's a big.
Wonderful.
So thank you, back to you.
Back to you.
Ethnic and cultural backgrounds. they must like shape people's perspectives, right? And the question here is that how do cultural differences affect the mental health experience?
You know, that's really wonderful. You know, ethnic and cultural background plays a very big role in who we are. You know, I believe it forms the building block of anybody's mentality, their mindset. You think based on where you're from, how you were raised, how you see yourself. You know, the neighborhood you grew up in. Affects how you relate to people. You see, I'll take myself an example. When I came here to this country, where I'm from, you know, everyone knows everyone. Everyone is friendly, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, you know everyone right down the street, you know. Everyone is, you know, when I came here, I lived in a house for 5 months. I didn't even know who my neighbor was. It was something hard for me because where I'm from, culturally, I like to know who my neighbor is, I like to know the last person on the street is, I want to know what, you know, like just to make friends. I didn't, and it was a cultural shock for me. It's not that it's wrong, but it was different. It was hard for me. I didn't know how to do it. I didn't know if I could open up, you know, because like I said, different backgrounds, different ethnicity, it gives you a different kind of mentality. You see, like, again, going back to like where I'm from, there are things that you can't do, the things you can't take. If you are going through an issue, it's hard for you to take a personal issue to anybody. You try to, because where I'm from, if you do that, there's some sort of stigma. They kind of look at you as though you're weak. You see, they look at you as though you're weak. So if you're going through any mental crisis, you can't really share with anyone. But you try to fix it by yourself, you see, and it transcends. So when you leave that area, maybe you come to this country, you're going through issues, you need help, but you find it difficult to open up because of your culture, of the way you were raised.
And
stigmatization, yeah. So all of that plays a role in the choices you make. Mm-hmm. Should you tell anyone about how you're feeling? Should you keep quiet? Mm-hmm. Should you try to fix it on your own? So all of that plays a role. I mean, I used to work with the late Yemi as a residential assistant, and I saw so many people from different countries. I remember a lady, that's last year, I think so, last year, early last year, when she came to this country. She didn't have any friends. She tried to make friends, but it was hard. She said the people she met were a bit violent for her liking, you know, a bit aggressive. So she didn't have any friends, and she was planning to kill herself. And they called me, the security guys called me to talk to her. So when I sat next to her, and I just smiled, I didn't ask her, well, why are you trying to kill yourself? I just started talking about different things, about where I'm from. And then she said to me, this is the first time since I came to this country that someone has spoken to me like this. Everyone has just talked about party, she's not a party person. Everyone talks about different things. So culturally, it affects your response and how you live. So culture does play a big role in us. Right, now, the next question goes back to women. Good, okay. So how can women better understand their mental health and develop empowering approaches to overcome their challenges?
Okay, that was a good question that came in. I don't want to say that this is generalizing or anything like the way, so this can apply to anyone and could be advice to anybody. So as the question goes, how can we better understand our mental health and empowering approaches to overcome those things? Some of the first things, like I really love what Meros was here to say, and I'm really happy that he came and spoke about such things as recognizing that you're going through something. It does not mean to say that, you know, it's wrong or it's bad or that it even defines you. There's no point labeling one emotion and saying, oh, I'm so moody, I'm so angry or something, and defining that as your nature. No, that's not where your nature comes from. And so for me, the first thing is recognizing that going through emotions or going through phases where you don't understand whatever is going on is something that you don't have to actually hold down to yourself or hold down to people and what people say or stigmatize about those particular emotions. I think social media has an influence in how, for example, women or just anyone can see their mental health in regard to, for example, memes or something that talk about, oh, when your woman is doing this, or when girls do this, or when women do that. And those things can start to kind of ingrain in your mind and make you think, okay, this is happening to me, it's bad, it's negative, but I have to accept it as who I am, or defining my nature, and then I don't know how to cope with it. And then you're stuck in that loop, and then it keeps happening. Now, although, for example, hormone changes have a different, like a certain impact on women, recognizing that, okay, I'm going through some emotions of sadness or overwhelm, can then make you think, how can I turn this into a positive, or like how can I channel energy into something else? One of the things that are really good in overcoming that is not wallowing. What I mean by wallowing is basically ruminating over and over again over a certain emotion or feelings, and it doesn't mean neglect your feelings, but you think about something, acknowledge that you're going through it, and then start to sort of think, do I want to sit here and keep crying? Maybe cry for half an hour and that's your threshold, and you're like, okay, I've let it all out, now what's next, you know? I believe not losing that sense of like a bigger picture or a bigger purpose to things in general really helps. So if you keep internalizing the issue and focusing on the issue itself, it might make it really hard to approach it, because there is no definitive way of handling a certain emotion like we've just spoken. But if you can take that emotion and think, okay, I acknowledge this is how I'm feeling, I acknowledge that it's making me behave a certain way. What can I do about this? Let me cry. And then after that, what are you going to do? It's not just crying, that's your coping mechanism, but what are you going to do after that? Are you going to speak to someone? Are you going to look to the bigger picture of what you have to do in your daily life? And yeah, I think that's, without prolonging the answer, that's for me in a nutshell. How to sort of recognize and deal with those challenges. So I ask again to Mr. King, how can upbringing influence men in expressing themselves, and how can society help resolve men's mental health challenges?
Thank you for the question. That's a very good question in terms of how, like, the topic that I don't think it gets talked about enough. And I'm going to go back to what Frankie said, was very interesting. Is that men, what I realized in my study is men tend to take on what they see. Be very visual learners. Anything you see growing up is what you carry on. So if as a man you grow up, this is how you see probably the closest man in your life, from your dad, your uncle, or your brother, you see certain behaviors. That is what most likely is what you have inherited. So, you know, most of how we learn how to express it, like Frank said, the first bit of society we get to interact with, which is family. That's the closest portion of society we are being introduced to. That's where we learn all our behaviors, traits, and where we learn how to socialize. And that plays a huge part of how we learn how to express ourselves. So, I think a society needs to understand, you know, basically do more to.
Can I read that question this morning? How can students achieve a growth mindset and sustain a sense of purpose during their education? That's a good question, thank you. Well, I feel like you know, students can, one thing in my personal experience is like including each other into activities, like thank you Gibbon for, you know, including me in what you're doing, thank God that I'm here today, and yeah, it's like, it's really, I think it's that inclusive mindset. The mayor was speaking earlier about people being like left out sometimes and being like people with like mental health issues, that they're often like left out, and I feel like, you know, I don't always feel like it's my place to reach out to somebody necessarily, but sometimes it is, and sometimes it's when it's your place to reach out to someone, then it's then just having the courage to, having that courageous mindset to make that move, and just, even if it's just a little joke, little conversation, little something that you make contact with someone and you have a conversation, you smile, or you have an inquiry with someone, I don't know, it's whatever is going on, you get involved in that, and I feel like that is really important when it comes to mental health. It's easy to be, when you're in a really, you know, good place, and when you have like, you know, you have your family supporting you, your friends supporting you, sometimes it's easy to like let some people just kind of slide by. Well, it's, you know, sometimes you just gotta catch them. Give them a hug. Yeah, that's all I got to say there.
Thank you. Miss Abidemi, thank you so much guys for listening. That was our panel discussion. We still did have it, and I hope it was helpful for you and for people that do watch this online. Thank you so much guys. That was unfortunately the end of our panel discussion. We would have loved to extend it, and thank you so much Michael, Mr. Caleb, Miss Abidemi and Mr. Frankie for your time, for your answers and digging that out of your heart. I'm pretty sure it came from somewhere, from experiences and things that can actually empower other people. So thank you so much. That will be the end of everything.